Hello everyone, Dungeon Frog here, and today I will give you a short overview about the Sorcerer update, about the Sorcerer class, without playing it, but with my knowledge of being a DM for quite some time and finishing up the game, I want to explain a bit to you about the Sorcerer. And this is a new class, a charisma-based class. So if you want to min-max, you probably want to choose a race which has a bonus to charisma. And that's probably for the min-max way, the half-elf, as it gets +2 to charisma. And maybe the first question, when do we actually want a sorcerer? And that's pretty obvious if you like to have a sorcerer. Then just take it, but as you can see, it's a charisma based class, and so it can be the face of your group and use all the talking actions. And so usually you want a paladin in before for that, but now you can go with the sorcerer. And also a good possible face character would be a rogue, but I mean, you could make a whole group out of clerics and it would work out, but especially if your character needs a face and you already have like a fighter or a ranger or a cleric and your frontline is full, then maybe don't go for the paladin but go for the sorcerer. And here you can see its class features, which are pretty much the same as in the original D&D game. And we see two saving proficiencies, Constitution and Charisma, which are, especially Constitution is a huge saving proficiency. Charisma is so whatever, there are not many Charisma saves in the game, but when Charisma throws matter, they matter a lot. So, decent saving proficiencies. The weaponry is pretty poor, even if it looks pretty cool. It gets only some basic items. Probably you would start with the range option, but you could opt out for a quarterstaff. Here it's whatever, choose what you prefer. You already get a melee weapon and sorcerer outfit, which is AC set to 10 and dex bonus. So he is a squishy class, even if he has he has 1d6 hit dice multiplier, so you will be only always on the light side of the life pool, same as with the wizard. So try to avoid taking it into melee combat other for specific builds. And there might be definitely a specific melee sorcerer build, but to that I will talk later. The skill sets you can choose from is probably you want some of the charisma skills, persuasion, intimidation, deception, but you also could get them through one of the origins. So I probably would prefer to get all three of the talking skills and then whatever is missing to you. The big thing about the sorcerer is not only his sorcerer's origin, which gives him some extra spells like the wizard spell schools, but also the magical crafting is not that important, but it's also nice to get two proficiencies in crafting right from the get-go. That's I think more than everyone else. I think he has smithing and he has magical crafting, and this one has magical crafting and also herbalism crafting. So strong feats here. The other thing which is specific about the sorcerer are his sorcery points and the meta magic option. Sorcery points pretty much work like you get 1 point per sorcerer level. They restore at long rest, and you can either alter your skills with the meta magic options in different ways, which we will look at the end of the video, and to able as a bonus action converse some of your sorcery into spell slots, or vice versa. Other than that, you get the typical level 4 and level 8 ability score choice improvements, like for all caster classes. And interesting, you now see what you would get at level 12, maybe hinting on another expansion. And with that, let's look what for Sorcerer's Origins we have be able to decide. And the first one is the Draconic Bloodline. That's the one that they were able to take out from the original in D&D. You must know that this game runs on an open D&D license, and that's why many spells which have an original name which is copyrighted by Wizards of the Coast are not allowed here. That's why you find some different gods, you find some different enemies and some spells which have a trademarked name not here. But you're allowed to use one of the original classes, and they did choose for the Draconic Bloodline and two new ones, Mana Painter and Child of the Rift. And I won't go any on any lore aspects of those classes, as I would spoil out, but overall I think they all fit in the lore. That's what I can surely say. And interesting, they give the Draconic Bloodline an origin spell list, which is a new design aspect of D&D Sorcerers. And they deviate from this new object, because usually the old sorcerer classes didn't get any additional spell slots, spells known. And the two newest ones in Tasha's Cauldron of Everything, a great book, I would definitely advise you to buy it, do get actually two spell slots always prepared. And they choose to opt out for one spell slot, which is an interesting case to be in, because I think with two spell slots, the sorcerer would have always have more spell slots than the wizard class prepared, so it would be a more diverse class. Even if you have to subtract that wizards actually can use their spell books to always have the rituals prepared, but I don't think it's working in Celesta here anyhow, so they opted out to give them one sided origin spell list, and I will probably rate things from S to D tier to make it more clear how well they are. And this spell list is huge, huge, huge. It's a really, really great spell list, which the Draconic Bloodline normally does not have. But you have a full list of spells you probably would take either way, as Shield is a great reaction spell and helping your defenses to increase by 5. And they changed in this patch finally that you can upcast spells even if they don't have any additional effects while upcasting. So you can shield now also with a level 2, 3 or higher spell slot, making this spell much more valuable. And yeah, whenever your character gets attacked, you pretty much will shield. So a really, really good spell. Misty Step and a bonus action teleport spell, so that after you get attacked, can move away. Huge spell. Also helps you on some situations where you need to pass through different locations if you don't have a character who can jump far, an option which you could take here. Counter spell to counter enemy spellcasters if you roll the dice. And the sorcerer is probably one of the best classes for countering spells. So great spell. Greater invisibility can have its uses. It's a concentration spell which pretty much gives disadvantage to enemies when they attack you as long as you're concentrating on it. So good defense off option, probably not the best, but it also have through invisibility some outside combat usability, so decent spell. And hold monster is, I think, a spell they just added with this patch. Concentration check to make a monster paralyzed, which is a good CC spell if you have an enemy who has problems with resisting this spell, as it's a wisdom saving throw. And yeah, if you can permanently shot a mob down, it's a huge game changer. So So then we have a Dragon Ancestors choice feed. You get 4 choices, which are not all the dragon types here are. You can choose whatever you want. Probably for a min-maxer, we want fire, as you can think, it's the most common damage type. You can speak a Draconic, which is nice, I guess. I think I never had really problems with the choosing that we have every language, but yeah, if you ever get in trouble, you have one more language. Nice. And but we have to check if there is actually a Draconic language. So let's remind this, because usually in D&D you can learn it. I'm not sure if you can learn it in Celesta. You gain 1 additional hit point per level, and your armor class is 13 plus your dexterity point when you're not wearing armor. That's what I said. In the defense department, you could make probably a Draconic melee fighter with this increased dexterity modifier and the increased base modifier if you would go for a Charisma Dexterity Sorcerer, which is probably the second best stat after Charisma and Con for your Sorcerer. So options here, opening, and those are the same in the D&D original book. And you later get at level 6 the ability to to get your charisma modifier to the total damage output of the spell. That's huge if you specialize on one of your damage ones. So a huge increase on damage, totally worth it. And you also can get resistance to an hour at the cost of 1 sorcery point. That is pretty situational, but you usually see in what area you are, so you can actually use it quite nicely. But if you play not a frontliner, you usually don't need really a resistance, because you usually don't want to get your sorcerer hit anyhow. But in the melee spec, it's probably better. But this one is probably better in the caster spec. So overall, decent talents, but just 2. So not the greatest list of points, but overall some strong abilities you get from the abilities here. Let's go for the next class. We have the Mana Painter, and you get Entangle, a concentration AoE skill, which is a CC skill. Can be useful especially against a group which you might surprise and which are on the ground and not able to fly. Decent skill, but we do get a lot of good concentration options, so a really, really strong spell in the early game. Falls down. Barkskin, a decent spell, a bit less useful. I mean, it's okay. It can be used, but you also could use Blur or Greater Invisibility as a defense skill. Not the hugest fan on Barkskin, so a decent skill. Oh, I didn't rate Draconic, so this is definitely an S tier class. Really good class. Overall, the spell list is great, the features are great, and do give you some options for a melee spec. So let's go on here. Sleetstorm, control, another AoE controls spell. So also a decent one, lets you shape up the field in a kind of similar way to Entangle. So it's more or less an upgraded form of it. Not a bad spell, but goes for the same theme pretty much. And I usually like to prefer to just kill your enemies than to CE them. So yeah, not the greatest spell, but not the worst spell. Fire Shield is a late game kinda defensive option for your character if you probably also prefer to go in melee range, because it's really situational if you don't go in melee range. Decent spell, and it's good to have it always prepared. And Conjure Elemental, summoning another concentration spell, helping you getting a creature out. Decent spell. I think I still did not lose concentration. So in the original D&D, If you lose concentration on your conjure spell, the elemental will run a rampage. I did not see in my playthrough that my hunter did lose concentration on his summoning spell, so I don't know if also in this game the elemental will go rampage. But if you have knowledge about it, write it in the comments. The game is not that long out, and I always am interested for new things. Let's check the level 1 feature. You only get 1 instead of 3. But it's a really, really, really strong one. Your charisma modifier is used if fire instead of other ability modifies on your saving throws against spells and other magic effects. And this might be, yeah, it's hard to say what in this game means and other magic effects. Like, is Dragon Breath, is this other magic effect? Or is it attack? Like, it's not totally clear to me in this game how it's ruled, as the game sometimes deviates from original D&D rules. But overall, this is a huge one, as you have against spell always. You want to max out your charisma modifier to a plus 5, and that would mean you always have a plus 5 to all of your saves, which are coming from spells. And so wisdom and dexterity, that's pretty huge, as especially wisdom saves are a pain to deal with, and dexterity saves come up a lot, so that's huge. It doesn't matter that much for strength saves, as usually if you have to make a strength save, you're up against the melee enemy and he probably won't use it as a magical ability. So not that much here, but overall it's a great, great defensive ability. I'm not sure if it's better than all of the free ones here, but it's a great ability, and you don't have to care about it, because you always want to make your charisma score anyhow. So great, great ability, and but it's a defensive one. Let's look at the other two skills. Again, we only have here one option instead of two on the dragon spell list. You get mana drain, make a melee spell attack, so that means you need to be in melee spell range, but it uses your spell attack modifier, so pretty much the same as your casting modifier. And on a successful hit, the target creature takes 1d10 plus your charisma modifier in force damage, so that will be 1d10 plus 5 in the end game. Force damage is a really good damage type. It's not often resisted, so that, and you regain 1 sorcery point. You need to take a short rest to recover this power. So this ability is really, really, really strong at level 2, and probably, yeah, and it gets weaker with every level up you take, and its utility gets worse. So it's of course better if you are on a melee character, as you will use it more often. But being a melee sorcerer without the draconic defense increase is probably nothing for early game. So this makes it harder. And usually if you are in melee spell attack range, oftentimes you just want to run away, and then it's probably smarter to take your action to disengage than making a melee attack. But there are some cases where you maybe can kill your enemy with a d10 plus 5, and then you can use one of your subtle, one of your meta magics to cast another spell as a bonus action. We will come to the options there later, the meta magic option. But this combo would be a really strong one, casting this as a melee attack and then give as a bonus action another attack. Really strong combo here, which maintains some of its late-game usability. But yeah, I would wish that they would increase, probably plus your maybe proficiency bonus, as this increases with time too, making it even stronger at low levels, but giving it some aspect to use it or more often, or maybe not to take it as a short rest. I mean, short rest is fine, but let it be usable for your charisma or constitution modifier times wise, that you could use it more often, and that it might increase in the later game. So a decent ability, but yeah, I think I would love it. We would have some more late game viability. Mana tap. When you finish a short left, you can regain a number of sorcery points equal to half your sorcerer level. Rounded up, you must complete a long rest to use this ability again. So this gives us pretty much more sorcery points, which interesting is also with this saying that you are better in short rest, which gives it, I wouldn't say a small advantage about the wizard, because the wizard has arcane recovery, which also gives you a spell slot. So overall, it won't give you such a huge advantage on spell slots, but you get more sorcery points options, and if your build is around using those sorcery points in specific ways, this might be a really useful way. But that's a critique on my side on the game. You are not punished enough for taking a long rest. So you most of the time can just take a long rest and it's not punished. So if the game would punish long rest a bit harder, then these abilities would become more useful. And I try to make as few long rests as possible, because I think it's more realistic for a real D&D game. But some people might decide not, and then this ability is a bit worse. So overall, I think the spell list is probably a B tier list. It has its options, but it's nothing where I would say this is actually a must-have. While I would say Shield, Misty Step, Counterspell are all pretty much must-haves on many builds, and Hold Monster is also a great, great spell. I wouldn't say here's anything a must-have. So, but they are all decent spells. So B, this is probably an S tier or an A tier ability. But it's only one. Here again, probably a really good early, an S tier early tier ability, but it drops off. And this one, sorry, it's probably only a C tier in this game. Not that much use as other for specific builds. And let's check out the third one, Child of the Rift. We get Guiding Bolt, a Daylight Banishment, Greater Restoration. Guiding Bolt is a really strong attack spell, which does radiant damage a huge amount on it, and if it hits, the next attacker gets advantage on his attack. So he rolls two dice and takes a higher result. Really, really great spell. It does not profit that much from upcasting, so it gets worse in the late game. But overall, it is a great spell, especially at early levels. So good spell. 8, you get some max HP. And this spell is good, and I like to take it, and I would take it on a priest usually. So great spell, and it's even better on the sorcerer, because one of the meta magic options lets you double the duration of the spell, and with that 8 becomes, I think, a 16 hour long spell, so you can cast it before a long rest and probably do the long rest and still have 8 ongoing. So really, really, really a huge skill which synergizes really well with the wizard class. You also can do this on the D&D class of the Clockwork one, the new one in Tasha's. So this makes the spell super, super huge, and it's probably one of the best skills on a sorcerer. Daylight, to be honest, I was not really high on the spell, but I will say it comes handy, especially in this game. So I would rate, I would probably never take it, so I'm really happy. I would be really happy if I would have it always prepared. So actually a decent one. Banishment is a huge, huge offensive spell. I think it's a charisma save, and it fails. It just is transported into another dimension. So that's a huge CC tool. And charisma, as I said, is not that often resisted as with wisdom. So good roll, strong spell. So you got Guiding Bolt, which is super strong, 8, which is super strong, Banishment, which is super strong, Daylight, which is decent in this game, and Greater Restoration, I don't know. maybe not useful. I didn't encounter that many situations to use it in my playthrough, so I'm quite skeptical and probably the weaker spell out of those five. And I would still give it probably an S tier as a spell list. It might be a bit less useful than this one, but I think this one is more fun. If you're not playing a melee build, then this one is fun, more fun. But for a caster, I would prefer this. And let's check out the Rift Magic. Immediately after you cast the sorcerer spell of level 1 to 5, which is the spell range you have actually in the game at the moment, roll a d20. If you roll a 20, your spell slot is not spent. So, same point as with the Mana Painter. You can make pretty easy long rests. So this spell slot is overall a bit less useful in this game, as making long rest is not punished that hard. But it might come up in a fight, and that would let you cast another spell in the fight, which is could be, yeah, it's pretty random, and if you like the random aspect, it's really fun and can turn over a fight. I mean, if you get, like, in your third level spell slot, you get the fireball, and at the moment you get it, fireball is such a strong spell. I mean, it's always a good spell, but at the moment, it's like, you probably can destroy armies with your fireball at the moment where you get it, and if you can just recast it, then, yeah, you probably will faith roll over the situation. So, if you feel lucky, if you like RNG, it's a really interesting ability. But, yeah, if you're not lucky and the chances are not that high to regain anything, then it's not that great. So I would say it's probably worse than both of those other spell features. But, like I said, there are moments where it's actually better. And, yeah, if you like RNG, it's probably better. We again get only two abilities here. The first one is Rift Deflection. You can use your bonus action to spend one sorcery point to become harder to hit and achieve better saving throws until the start of your next turn. I have to say that I don't like it. Because, well, the first thing you have to think is what do you want to spend your bonus action actually on? So if you plan for a character who has his bonus action totally open, then, as this one also uses your bonus action, this class becomes better. But if you actually want to use your bonus action to do stuff with it, and there are some options what you could do with your bonus action, then this becomes worse or better. You have to spend one sorcery point, and I mean, you get one per level. So it's a kinda rare source, and you don't have that many ways to regain them other than in a long rest. So, I'm not a huge fan about this, but it's also hard to decipher from this description what it actually means, because it says becomes harder to hit and achieve better saving throws until the start of your next turn. So, it does not say what actually happens. I would guess you get advantage, and the enemy get disadvantage on his rolls. So, that makes you better, but you also have probably your shield. You could cast a blur mirror image, you could misty step out of the fight, you could use your action to disengage because you maybe want to do it anyhow if melee characters actually are able to hit you. And that is like, it's only until the start of your next turn. So you actually have to think, okay, the enemy will actually probably attack my sorcerer, which is usually not the best place to be in. As I said, sorcerers are squishy. And you have to anticipate you are getting attacked and you are getting hit, so that this will become worse. So it's probably the worst skill so far I did read about. I totally don't like it. But maybe you have some options to defend it, but I think this one is sadly a no-no for me. Let's read the sixth one, Offering to the Rift. You can use your bonus action to sacrifice 5 hit points permanently, which is a bit against the 8th skill, as you get more HP here and lesser here. In order to regain immediately one sorcery point, the sacrificed hit points are removed after are recovered after a long rest. So you can stack it up, I guess, and do it every turn, which is interesting. So you actually have a safe way to recover your sorcery points, which makes the skill a bit better, but I'm still not a huge fan of it, because, yeah, I actually really like the idea to sacrifice hit points. This is if you watch Critical Role on one of Matt Mercer's homebrew classes, one of the main themes, and I think it's a really cool idea, even if a lot of people I think don't like it, but it's a really cool exchange to sacrifice something to get some gain. So conceptually, I really like it, and this is probably a good way to get sorcery points back, and also you could transform it with another bonus actions into spell slots, but we don't first have that many spell slots, hit dice, so this becomes maybe a bit better on a dwarf, because there's one dwarf which gives you extra HP. Interesting, maybe combination to play this as a dwarf would also shape up the meta a bit. And yeah, you get one sorcery point, and you see, we will see that there are different sorcery point costs, and you probably have to think about something really specific to make the most out of it. So I'm not sure how I would rate this ability. It's really good for a long fight, but I wouldn't say you don't have that many long fights. I mean, that's okay. So, not sure about this ability. It would require some playtesting. I think I would give this probably a D, and this probably an A. So, overall, this is a more random class. I would think the strongest one is probably the Draconic Bloodline, but I would probably try to build around the other two. So overall, a great class selection here, with different strength, different vibes, different story aspects. Good selection. And let's go on. Background remains the same. You take whatever you want and what fits best to your character and to your group. I usually would prefer to use the standard array, because this is like pretty much the get-go to make balanced groups and to may not make overpowered groups. So you definitely or otherwise go for point buy, which I even prefer over the standard array, as it makes every character the same. And you of course want charisma as high as possible. The rest goes into constitution, and then the rest goes into dexterity. That's probably the min-max way, but you can opt out for the other ones and go also here for strength and charisma. So you want to finish definitely off your charisma to 20, and con, yeah, maybe if you can get it to 18, but it's not a must have. But yeah, definitely get charisma to 20. So that's probably the min-max point pie system that you would like to have. Proficiencies, like I said, try to fill out your group. I chose one of them. Got some from the things you probably want here, all of the four full. And then I would probably go for stealth if I could, as I think stealthing is really nice. But maybe if it's your only magic character, you could go for Arcana, the ancestry language, I think. Still not sure if Draconic. Oh! Also part of the rules that invalid for role-playing purposes, this element is not used in the Crown of Magister main campaign. Okay, so that's maybe why we did not find it. So this actually does not bring you anything now, but I hope they will implant something which actually uses Draconic and makes it able to use for every class. I just chose some languages by random. Just fill out that you have all the languages chosen. Spells, it pretty much has the same spell list as the wizard, and I'm at the moment the dragon class caster, And cantrips, yeah, try to, especially if you go for the dragon one, to get matching ones to your dragon. And if we go for the fire one, we definitely want to have firebolt. I definitely like shadow armor as it can give me some extra life. I would advise you to probably never use true strike as it's not a good spell. And you probably should never take it. And from that you have different options. Probably you want to have a melee attack. That's probably shocking grasp for me. And another option, which I would maybe take light. But you have could opt out for another damaging skills one. And shield is a great option you already got from your domain. And you have a lot of good options here. You probably, if you don't want to spend the gold, you want to have detect magic. And does that have identify? Do I not see identify? Okay, so you somewhere need to get identify or use gold here. Could use detect magic as a ritual to cast it more often to find to save some money. But burning hand is especially good with the dragon caster as it does fire damage in a melee range cone, so it's overall a really good AoE spell for early levels. Feather Falls is sadly not that useful, but it has uses, but I wouldn't take it at the beginning. But if an enemy pushes you somewhere down, or one of your mates, you can actually use your reaction to stop the damage here, so I like the spell. Force Life is a bit better on melee specs, as you get a decent temporary hit buffer here. This gives you some movement, maybe on the melee part, decent. Mage Armor, I'm not a huge fan of it, but if you want to play a melee one with a not draconic origin, might be really useful, especially in the early levels, to have it. It's also good combined with the doubled duration spell, which you get from your meta magic, which we are talking about later. And Sleep, another control spell, which is better for the ones who does not gain the Entangle spell, also a really good spell. Thunderwave pushes away enemies, also friends, and does decent damage, also a great spell if you expect the enemies to be closer. And Magic Missile, the skill which always hits. So if you play a range one, I probably would go for Magic Missile and Thunderwave or Sleep. Maybe Sleep. That would be my choice for a ranged draconic spell list, as I will try not to get into melee combat at the first two or three levels, and if I get where I get my shield as a defense cover up. So that would be my decisions, but on a melee one, and also in some cases Burning Hands would be a really good one. Mage Armor, Force Life, you have a Thunder Wave, you have, and of course Shield if you don't have it, you have a great spell selection here. Identity, I will just skip it and write something here so that we can finish it. And let's look for the character here and level it up to see actually the progression for our two first spell slots. Because then we get the sorcery point options and the meta magic option, and that will give us a broad overview over the class. And if you actually want to see some specific character builds from me, then write it in the comments. But yeah, if I would level up it more, then I would probably have to lean to one specific build. And for that, you usually also want to have a party to make it a perfect use. So at level 2, you gained some hit points, of course. And yeah, you get your sorcery point, 2 points because you're level 2. And you are able to convert your spell slots into sorcery points and vice versa. Which is actually stronger as in the normal book, as I think you have to pay a different rate usually to convert sorcery points into spell slots. So you sorcery points are actually even worth a bit more than usually you have So, a good option here. That's one of the main features of the Sorcerer. And at level 3 we get something more. We can unlearn a spell and get a new one. We won't change anything. And at level 2 I probably would take Thunderwave. It's probably too early to have any use of Detect Magic. But I am actually a Red Fire one. So I wouldn't take Thunderwave, but Burning Hands as a skill for my character. And let's go on with the level 3 upgrade, just to see what meta magic options we do get. Again, we get some spell slots and stuff, but we open the meta magic option, which is what we want actually out of this class, and probably one of the main reasons why you play this class. And let's see how many options we get in comparison to the original D&D. We get another... Oh, they are on proficiency, it seems. So here we have the options. One is careful spell. Allied creatures affected by the spells automatically succeed their saving throw, and it's only costing one meta magic point. So this is a buff in comparison to the original careful spell, as all your allies do not get any effects. I'm not sure if there is any case where you want to not... the usual does let you choose how many allied creatures are not affected, and you have to pay more if you want to select more. So here you always get the full amount. And when do you actually use careful spell? And one of the situations would be if you fireball the enemies, then also your friends have to roll the damage, and with that fireball does no damage to them. So a really good option to save your group. And there are also different uses, but probably the fireball option is the best, and it only costs 1 point. So if you try to make a boom boom spell list, really good thing to have. Distance spells. Doubles the range of a spell or changes the range of touch spell to a 30 feet. This one is a really specific one, because you have to always check how you want to play it, what spells you choose, what distances they have. It also depends actually of the maps you are in. So obviously if you have long and big maps, this meta magic, and you have two meta options now, and you later get more with the leveled up. So you could I would say if you want to take this, you probably want to build around it and focus about it, especially if you switch some touch spells to range spells. There are some specific build diversities, but if you are not planning to build around it, probably not the best option to choose, even if it only costs 1 point. So, same as in the original D&D. Empowered spell. 2 points, same here, but the difference is different. All damage rise rolls of one or two are reroll, keeping the new result. That might be a strong one, especially again, if you use it with Fireball. Then I think you roll 8 dice, and 1 and 2 are rerolled, so you at least get 24 damage out of it. So that's huge. I think that is really a good one, but of course you want a build which uses a lot of hit dice, probably an AoE heavy build. So in that case, this spell is really strong. Extended spell, I already talked about it. It increases the duration. Or it doubles up the duration. Same here. To a maximum of 24 hours. There are some specific spells which you have to take to make it worth it. And 8 is one of the one. Magic armor is another one. And there are probably other spells. You could use it with sleep, I think, would be one, so that he probably never awakes. kinda off this, but usually he wouldn't awake anyhow. So there are some specific spells, but in that cases it's probably worth to take it. And in cases where you don't have the spells, don't take extended spell. Heightened spell. Can force a creature to roll the saving throw with disadvantage. I'm not sure if this one is different in original D&D. I think it... I'm not sure if it's with disadvantage or if it ought... I think it's, yeah, it also rolls with disadvantage. And it costs 3 sorcerer points. I have to look it up for a second because I'm not 100% sure if it's the same. It also costs 3 sorcery points. And it gives a spell disadvantage on its first saving throw made against the spell. To roll the saving throw, yeah, because roll the saving throw with disadvantage. So it's also probably against the first one. So the same one here. Yeah, if you get like a dominate monster, like a really key, or banishment, like a really key spell you want to succeed on, then this is the one you want to take. A really good one, but also you need the specific skills to use it. Quicken spell, probably the one you use the most. It has most options here. It costs 2 points, and you can cast as a main action spell with a bonus action instead, though you can't cast another spell during the same turn except for a cantrip. So you actually could take the fireball cantrip as your action and then cast a bonus action fireball. That's why you also have, if you, yeah, so you can do some really damaging turns with this combination, or like I said, use one of the class features and then quicken another spell out. Really, really a lot of uses, really bursty turns with quicken spell, and it uses up your bonus action, making the other class a bit less useful if you use quicken spell constantly. But overall, I think it's probably of all of the spells the one which you can build into most characters and have the most uses. So I think it's probably always a must-have to actually take quicken spell. And the last one we have is twin spells. If the source spell targets one creature only, this adds another target. So this one is the same as in D&D. The sorcery point cost depends on the spell level. So 1 point for a level 1 spell, 2 points for a level 2 spell. And yeah, you can twin like your invisibility on two characters. You can, and that's probably the strongest use, twin your haste on two characters and would lose 3 sorcery points, but man, twinning a haste spell is one of the strongest things you can do. I hope this class actually gets the haste spell, but yeah, you have like your concentration spells you could twin, so there are some really good options here. And yeah, if you have some melee characters in twinning haste on them, super, super strong option. And yeah, overall a really versatile spell with this specific spell. So also a great option. And you're missing some meta magic options from the original D&D. You miss the subtle spell, which is probably not that useful here in real D&D. You pretty much don't need your vocal and somatic components if you have subtle spell, which this game I don't think really determines anyhow. If you only need to have it equipped, and then it does not matter. And I think if you start from sneak your attack, it works anyhow. And not like in real D&D, if a character would sneak up on one of my enemy groups and he would start a cast spell, they would all get discovered immediately. And this is not like in this game, so you can just open a combat with your spell. But in real D&D this would not work, because usually your character would start to say some magic words and move his hands, and people probably would notice you. And so that's probably why they don't have the subtle spell, which is one of my favorite options. We also don't have the option to change the damage type of the spell. I think more a game engine problem than any other option that this is not here. So the option would expend a sorcery point to change maybe your damage from fire to acid, which would help making the draconic spell list a bit better, as you get extra bonus damage to spells of a chosen element. So that makes the draconic spell class a bit worse, but overall still really great if you prefer fire magic, especially. But yeah, those two are missing, and I think that's all they are missing. I think I have a quick view over mine, over my list. Oh, you also don't have the seeking spell, which makes you, if you make an attack roll or a spell and miss, you can spend 2 sorcery points to reroll the d20, and you must use the new roll. And you also is, and it's I think the only, no, it's not the only one, but with empowered spell, the only one which you can actually use while you already use another meta magic option. So they are exclusive, and it's not written here on the empowered spell if you can actually use it, but you probably can't use it because it's not written here. And it's, I think, better than the original one, so that's maybe the trade-off. And, yeah, you can't reroll your dice, probably, again, another engine choice. And I think it's a decent one, especially if you have one specific hit, which could, should hit, like maybe the acid arrow on an acid dragon spell, that you really want to hit this specific one, then this would be a really good one. But, yeah, like I said, overall, these are really specific ones, I think, except of the quicken spell. And as you get more options with the time, you can opt out for different options. And I would probably go with the empowered spell as my two first options on a not optimized character for some use. And yeah, I think overall the sorcerer class is a really, really great class. A really fun class. It's yeah, another option if you really want something different or have a charisma character in your group. So overall a really great class, and I hope you're excited to play with it. I think you get pretty much the spell same spells as the wizard, and there are again some options. Hold person for single target probably, and scorching ray for single target damage or AoE damage, and Shatter as the only AoE option. As we are a fire drake, I probably would take Scorching Ray or Levitate for dungeon discovering reasons. So yeah, thanks everyone for watching. If you want to see my Let's Play where I finished up the whole game with a pretty unusual group without any full caster, then look in my playlist or here in the section. And yeah, leave a follow, leave a subscribe, leave a comment. Thanks everyone for watching, and we see us in the next one. Goodbye.